welcome to the Mean Lady Talking Podcast, the tough-talking, advice-giving show by the not-really-mean, mean lady, Susan J. Elliott.
Good day, everybody. This is Susan Elliott, host of Mean Lady Talking Podcast, and welcome to episode 93. Now, I know that I recorded episode 93 before the Great Break, but I do not have access to it. It's on a laptop that's dead, and so I'm re-recording it. I have no idea, none whatsoever, what was on 93 that's on the other laptop. And so I'm going to just talk about what is relevant today. I don't know if you listened to the transitional podcast, and the reason that I didn't number those is because they really explain where I've been and where the podcast is going. There are some substantive stuff on there, but not a lot. So at some point in the future, I will probably delete them. In fact, I know for when I distributed them, I put an expire date on, which I think is like 6 months from now. But anyway, in case you caught wind of the transitional podcast and why they're not numbered, I wanted to let you know why. Okay, so one of the things that I want to say really quickly before we start the show is that I said that I was closing my client list August 1st, but I said that because I thought that I was going to get a podcast out by August 1st, and I didn't. So I'm closing my client list at the end of August. So if you want to be a private client, just send me email or go to the website, gettingpastyourbreakup.com. There's a link at the top that says GPYB coaching/counseling, whether it's divorce coaching or whether it's therapy counseling. Just go there and make an appointment for either consultation. I also do some email counseling, so that option is there as well. Again, I'm just going to sit down here. I'm going to talk about two things that keep coming up over and over again, two things I've talked about before and will probably talk about again. About 75 to 80% of my clients have exes who are personality disordered. And these two issues come up even for people who are not the former partners of somebody who's personality disordered, but people who have become estranged or broken up with. People with personality disorders struggle with these two things, especially. Okay, so housekeeping. One of the things is that I am going to start season 3 with episode 100. So I'm going to try to barrel through to that. If I can stop dealing with this heat, I will try to pump out 2 episodes a week in the coming weeks. But it's been too hot for me to turn off the air conditioning, and the air conditioning really screws up the sound. And as I told you guys, my sound has gone by the wayside. I'm still rebuilding it. And I want to thank my meanies, all of my Patreon supporters, who are helping me rebuild that with their donations. I really, really, really appreciate it. And I have some mini merchandise for you. Make sure I have your home address. And anyway, I'm going to try to get 2 episodes out a week, and I'm going to try to continue to build up the sound equipment, software, hardware, sound panels, you know, the whole 9 yards. And hopefully season 3 starts with a gigantic bang. So anyway, one of the things that people struggle with all the time is frame of reference. We look at the world how we ourselves are, and we have trouble imagining that other people are different, especially when we meet somebody that we feel we're compatible with. Part of that compatibility is our likeness. And it's true that a lot of us fall in love with people who are the opposite of us, and we admire things about other people that we are lacking. But for the most part, Carrie Fisher once wrote in one of her books, which I love all of her books, a friend is someone with shared sensibilities. And I think that many times we go into relationships with people, romantic relationships, believing that we have shared sensibilities, believing that we look at life the same way. And it is very, very important. And I go through this in Getting Back Out There. And one of the reasons I encourage people to read Getting Back Out There early in your breakup, long, long, long before you're ready to date, is because you have to start wrapping your head around these notions. that you do have to look at life the same way. And you do have to not have to explain things to people. Otherwise, you're fighting all the time. I remember people would ask me, because I can be cantankerous. I could be difficult. I could be moody. I could be a whole bunch of things, especially when I had all the kids at home. We had a dog. We had three cats. And Michael was a space cadet a lot of the times. And I would just feel like the only way this place is not going to look like an insane asylum is if I step in and tell everybody what to do all the time. And that's what led to, as I've talked about on other podcasts, the Gestapo notes. And I worked 12-hour shifts. If I said nothing to these hooligans who lived in my house, and I went off to work for 12 hours, I would come home, the place would be burnt to the ground. Or worse, God only knows. So I had to step in and be in charge a lot of the times. But when it came to dealing with life and loyalty and who is important and what is important, and being true and honest and real, Michael and I were totally on the same page with that stuff. Totally on the same page. He wasn't running around like my first husband was, moving people and doing favors for strangers and acting like the world's most lovable narcissist. He wasn't doing any of that. He was at home watching NASCAR while the kids were burning the house down, but he was still not out pretending to be something that he wasn't. Or he wasn't out entertaining other people at the expense of his family. And he wasn't out being the life of the party and then coming home and ragging on me. Because he didn't believe in that. He believed in being loyal and true to the people that are close to you. And he also believed in that being a very small circle, which I did too. I mean, neither one of us, we both had a lot of acquaintances, but neither one of us had a lot of close friends, nor did we want a lot of close friends. We absolutely believed in holding everybody that we cared about close to us and to giving them enough time and attention. And if you have a million people close to you, you cannot possibly give them a lot of time and attention. So even though on the daily logistical level, Michael and I did not see the world the same way, we saw life, loyalty, love, all of that stuff, all those big ticket items, all the real important stuff, we saw the same way. Now, when you go into a relationship, you have to try to figure that one out. And a lot of times you can't do it early on, which is why I tell people you have to shut up and observe and listen. Go to the workbook, listen to active listening, listen to observation, do the exercises, learn to hold back, learn to not tell everybody what you're thinking about everything. It's a date is not a job interview. You don't have to impress somebody. You have to let them impress you. And people have said to me, well, if I don't say anything, they might walk away. They don't have a good impression of me. They don't have any impression of me because I haven't said very much. If they like what you have presented so far, they will ask you about you. And again, you want to avoid being the target of a narcissist, so you don't want to give them a lot to mirror. You don't want to give them a lot to basically impersonate. So you want to hold some stuff close to the vest. Yes, you do want to get some points out there, but you don't need to tell them everything about yourself. You don't have to be there and spill the beans so that when you leave your first date, this person knows everything about you. And then if they don't want a second date, they have rejected all of you. See, if you don't tell them very much, and whatever they've had in front of them is not enough for them to feel interested in a second date, well, too bad, so sad. Move on. They don't know you. You can't feel rejected. They didn't reject you because they don't know you. You have to be very careful with your personal information, no matter who it is. You don't go around telling everybody everything. That just leaves you too wide open and too vulnerable. But you do have to know if somebody has the same frame of reference that you do. And that's why I talk about giving examples of things that have happened in your life, only you don't say, well, this happened to me, but you say, what would you do if, And then that's the answer. Now, as a bonus, coming back from the podcast, I have some mini episodes that I've been working on just for the meanies of stuff that I've never told on a podcast and pretty much haven't told a whole lot of people. So I have those things set to go. But one of the things that happened to me, and I don't know if I talked about this on a podcast, I really don't think that I did, but as a bonus to coming back, I'm going to talk about this right now. I was seeing a guy long distance. And so we only saw each other because I had my kids every other weekend. So we only saw each other every other weekend. And I always went there. And after a couple of months, I was going up there one Saturday morning and I got my period. I got it when I first got to his house and I said to him, I need to go to the drugstore and get tampons because I just got my period. And he said, okay, we went to the car, blah, blah, blah. And while we were out, he said that we should just get movies and we should have movie night and we should camp out in the living room. And I was like, okay, I mean, I'm not a camper, but he was a camper. And I told him I would never go camping outside. I said, my idea of camping is going to a hotel without room service. And so he was making a joke and he said, well, you'll never go camping outside. So let's go camping inside. And it was all very light and airy and funny and, you know, all kinds of things. So we went around, we went shopping, we visited with his mother, we visited with his friends. And later on that night, we went out, we picked up food, and we went back to the house, and we set up sleeping bags on the floor and bolster pillows. And we had a bunch of videos from the video store, back when there was a video store. And we started to watch the movie. And I started to snuggle up to him. And he was not reciprocating. And I was like, what is going on here? And he was very uncomfortable. And I could tell that he was uncomfortable. And I thought, was it something I said? Was it something I did? Should we turn off the movie and talk about this? I mean, what should we do? I thought we were having a nice evening. Now we're not having a nice evening. Now there's ice in the air. So I turned off the movie and I said, what's wrong? And he was like, nothing. And I was like, no. Something is wrong. What is it? And he said, let's just watch the movie. And I said, but I'm trying to like be affectionate with you and you're not returning the affection. So it tells me that something's wrong. And he said, no, nothing's wrong. He said, I just don't want to really be that close to you right now. And I said, what? Like, why? What did I do? And he said, no, you didn't do anything. But when women have their period, they're dirty. And I went, what? And yeah. And I went, what? Like, so what I found out was that I wasn't even going to get to sleep in his bed that night. He wanted me on the floor, on the sleeping bag, away from him because I was menstruating. I was like, dude, this is not happening. So I left. I mean, I was so angry. I was so angry. So anyway, yeah, the first night I met Michael and this like blew him away that I didn't say to him, this is what happened to me. But what I said to him was, we were going through 20 questions and all the 20 questions were based on things that had happened to me. Based in other relationships where I really had problems with it. Whatever the guy had done, I really, really had big problems with it. So I was asking 20 questions that night. I was doing, you know, sort of like a quiz show thing. And what I said to him was, I said, if a woman got her period, now I didn't say, would you push her away and not let her be affectionate with you? Because I had never heard of that with a guy ever. So I just assumed that this one guy was like the only guy that was going to be like that. But I said, if you were in a relationship with a woman and she got her period, would you want to make love with her that night? And he said, without missing a beat, without thinking about it, he said, whatever she would be most comfortable with. And that was not only the perfect answer, but it was the most honest answer. That was Michael. That was absolutely who he was. he had absolutely no problem. I mean, I used to tell him that I could be on fire and he would make love, but I could be missing a limb and my hair could be on fire and he would want to make love. I used to tease him about that all the time. At my period, I mean, like, well, why is that a problem? I don't get it. So, I mean, his answer was not only the perfect answer, but it was the absolute truth. I mean, whatever I wanted would have been fine with him. And it was more than just fine. So he told me later on that the fact that I asked him such an intimate personal question blew him away. And that he was so impressed with the fact that I was just out there. Like, I was just, this is who I am. These are the questions I'm asking. This is what's important to me. What's important to you? I was joking about the things that he did. And I asked him, like, what his favorite sport was, because the guy that I was with for a long time wasn't really into sports. And my kids were all into sports. And I sort of wanted to know if he was into any kind of sports. And my former boyfriend did take my kids to a football game. He did take them to practice, and he knew nothing about sports, so he couldn't talk about it, but he was active with them to some degree. So it wasn't like he was just like, I don't do sports, and that was it. But I just wanted to know. So I had gotten into the habit of asking guys that on a first date, like, what sports do you like? So Michael said he liked fishing, and I was like, fishing? Like, fishing isn't a sport? So I said to him, I said, there's a Stephen Wright line. There's a fine line between fishing and standing on the shore looking like an idiot. And Michael perked up and said, I have a boat. He was like, it's not standing on the shore looking like an idiot. He's standing in a boat looking like an idiot. So I was like, you have a boat? I was like, what are you doing with a boat? And he was telling me, I mean, he went off about all these stupid fishing things that he had, the sonar and the, you know, the depth finder, whatever the hell it's called. And I said, so you've got like $40,000 worth of equipment to chase this thing around that has the IQ of a can of paint. And then you feel really good about yourself when you haul it into the boat. And he goes, oh, yeah. He goes, I fish for smallmouth bass, and they're very smart. And I was like, smallmouth bass are very smart. I was like, okie dokie. And we just went back and forth. And the fact that he was able to kind of take the ribbing and give it back to me, and he wanted to, and talked about NASCAR as people driving in circles. And he said, sometimes there's oval tracks. I was like, no, they're going in circles. Let me explain this to you, buddy. They are going in circles. So he really got a kick out of it. But you have to learn what these people are about, what's important to them, what they care about. And you have to give them a little bit of information, but dressed up in a way that they can answer honestly. Because I wouldn't have told Michael the story about the guy, the long distance guy, because he would have just come back the first night that we met. And if he was feeling attracted to me, which he said he was going to say whatever he was going to say. It wasn't going to be as honest as it was when I asked him it the way that I did. And when we went out, he was so deferential to waitresses and so deferential to maitre d's and, you know, servers and people. And that's what I looked for. If somebody ignored them or talked down to them, I was like, I'm not dealing with this at all. I'm not dealing with anybody who talks to wait people like that. So early on, you need to be putting yourself out there to a certain degree, but you need to be taking information in because you want to push your frame of reference to the side for a while so that if you are saying to somebody, I'm generous, and you know what that means, and I've talked about this before, you know what that means. It means that you're there for somebody, you're willing to lend somebody money, you've helped out friends in need, you've done X, Y, and Z, and they say, oh, I'm generous too. You've now formed an impression that their generosity looks just like your generosity, and most of the time it doesn't. Or they're just a narcissist and they're just mirroring you and they're not generous at all. So you need to pull back on some information like that, especially those broad statements, because anything that they agree with, you're going to automatically frame it the way it looks like to you. So it's a good idea that even if you know what generous means, you say to somebody, just in case this happens to fall out of your mouth, if you say, I'm generous, and they say, I'm generous too, you say, what does that look like to you? Or give me an example of you being generous. Well, when was the last time you were generous? What are we talking about? And one of the examples that I've used over and over again, I think I use it in the workbook, is somebody could be saying, oh, well, my ex is kind of a financial doofus, so I have custody of the kids and I don't make her pay child support. That's not generous. That's stupidity. And you want to know that. Like, you want to know what they mean by generous, because you don't want their stupidity to be parading as generosity when it's not. Because if you're in a relationship with somebody who has custody of their kids and they're not getting child support, that's going to impact you negatively. So you want to know that. You want to know that they're a complete idiot for their ex. I mean, you want to know that. You can ask open-ended questions like, so what is your relationship with your ex like, you know, if they share children? You want to listen. You want to listen to what people have to say. When I asked Michael the very first night about his former relationships, he said, my first wife was an angel. And I was so impressed with that. And then he said, and my second wife is like the devil. And I was like, whoa. And it turned out that it was true. I mean, we went through hell with his second wife. And he told me some stories, and I said to him, well, what makes your first wife an angel? And he told me. So if somebody says something like that, my first wife was an angel, well, what was it about her that makes her an angel? And you want to listen to that, because it's telling you who they are, what impresses them, what makes them think positively about somebody. Well, what makes your second wife a devil? You want to know what makes somebody think something negative about somebody. So you want to ask open questions, and you want to keep your frame of reference and your prejudgment out of it, because every word, every descriptor that they use might not be anything like the way you would use it. So you really want to dig into things and not take it for granted that you know what things mean, because you don't. And you can ask them, like, what are your views on this or that? What are your views on cheating? What are your views on, you know, if somebody says, well, it happens. I mean, you're like, okay, bye-bye. It's not happening here, dude. So, you know, frame of reference is really important to keep it out, to know that not everybody in the world looks at life the way you do. And that when you meet somebody, you really have to think about it. Because every single one of my clients that were in relationships with personality disordered people, they are so shocked by the fact that the personality disordered have no empathy for them, don't care about them, don't love them, don't care about their feelings, are controlling nitwits. I mean, they just can't wrap their brain around it. What do you mean they don't care about how I feel? They don't. If somebody is a narcissist or a sociopath, they don't. They have no capability of caring about you or your feelings. It's that simple. And you can say, how could somebody be in a relationship with somebody and not care about their feelings? You just have to accept that that's true. And the people that struggle with this are the people that have the hardest time moving on, because they can't just accept that the bottom line is this person didn't care about you the way you thought they cared about you. They were going through the motions. They were play acting. They were pretending. They were trying to figure out how to make you believe that they cared about you. They do the minimum, and then when you're walking out, they suck you back in and they make all these promises and then they start it all over again. So you have to try to set aside your frame of reference where you can't imagine going through these motions, saying these things that your ex said to you when you have absolutely zero feelings toward a person. You can't imagine yourself doing that because you're not personality disordered. But take my word for it, that's what they do. It's what they do. And you just, as hard as it is to believe, as hard as it is to understand, you just have to bring yourself to a place where you can just wrap your head around it and go, okay, fine, uncle. I give up. I surrender. This person has never cared about me because they're incapable of caring. Everything they're doing is because they think that they're supposed to be in a relationship with somebody, or they're putting on appearances, or they're doing what they need to do. Sometimes, like with my first husband, I swear he evolved into a narcissist while we were together. Because we started out in high school and there were signs. I mean, there were red flags. There were, yeah, this is a narcissist in training. But I believe that he became a full-blown narcissist during our marriage, not before. And it took me a long time to realize that the guy who had said all these things to me, who had wooed me, who had been charming, you know, all those words that people use about narcissists, that it was all bullshit and it didn't mean anything and it was never going to mean anything. It just took me so long to figure that out. And once it hit me, and once I was able to accept it, just stop trying to understand it and just start trying to accept it, my life became so much easier. My brain stopped turning into spaghetti. Okay, so if you have questions about frame of reference, if you want more examples, if whatever it is, anything that I can do to help you understand this. And like I said, it's not just my clients with people with exes who are personality disordered. Everybody struggles with the frame of reference concept because we tend to judge people against who we are, but that's not who they are. The world is made up as many different types, and there's many people out there who do many things that you would never do. And you want to make sure that you don't wind up in relationships with them. Okay, so the second thing is tell my truth. I had a client, she kept saying this over and over again. I kept saying, why are you talking to your friends about a breakup? Why are you talking to your kids about your breakup? Because I want them to know my truth. Because our ex is a narcissist, and our ex is one of those overt narcissists everybody loves, everything's wonderful, blah, blah, blah. But, you know, he's been lying to her for years, has been cheating for years, been doing this, been doing that. And she keeps saying that she wants to set the record straight. The record is never going to be straight, and you're just going to sound like a bit of crazy person. People who want to believe you will believe you, but the majority of people are going to say, oh my goodness, is she bitter? Oh, nobody is going to be listening to all of that. Now, if you have coworkers that are going through your divorce and things like that, you can confide when you absolutely have to. But for the most part, keep your divorce proceedings, your upset with your ex, you know, anything that's going on legally, keep them away from your job. You need to go to work and you need to have clear peace of mind. I went through a bitter custody battle for 2 years, and I was close friends with the people that I worked with, and I never talked about it. Never talked about it. I didn't want to drag that crap onto my job. I was working as a software engineer. I had a technical job. I had to concentrate, and I certainly didn't want to spend my days talking about my stupid ex and all these stupid motions that he filed and all these investigations and this, that, and another. I just didn't want to. I wanted to leave it at home, and then I wanted to leave work at work. The thing is that if you are in a relationship with somebody who has done you very wrong, but the world loves him or her, they're going to continue to love him or her. You're not going to convince everybody. You're just not. And you shouldn't try, because many times people are going to hold you out as somebody who's just not getting over it, who's engaging in a public slugfest. If your ex is really a narcissist that everybody loves, they're just going to continue to love that person. I mean, there's a reason why they love them. And it's probably because they are able to spin lies into truth, and they're able to spin popular opinion their way. You're not going to change that. So stop trying. Put your attention back on your life, which is where it belongs. It doesn't belong with the ex. It doesn't belong in convincing people who the ex is, who the ex was, what the ex did. And what I said to this client was, you can say he lied to me for years, he cheated on me for years, and people are going to be, so what? You stayed with him. I mean, what does this say about you? You don't really want to put that stuff out there because you look like an idiot. Okay, guys, so those are two things that I want to talk to people about: frame of reference and quote unquote my truth. And I will have much more for you in the coming weeks. I hope to get to episode 100 very shortly. And if you have any questions, situations, comments, things you want me to talk about, please, please, please send me emails, shoot me a note on Patreon, shoot me a note on Facebook, talk about it, ask about it in the Facebook group, whatever it is you want to do, however it is you want to get in touch with me, just feel free. And I'll see you guys in the next podcast. Talk to you guys later. Take care, everybody. Bye-bye.